Okay, we're on to part two of this video, and we'll be focusing on inverse variation. Inverse variation. Okay, we've treated directs. So what does it mean to talk about inverse variation? It's like saying that, it's like looking at a child that is stubborn. You're telling the child, don't do this. But the very thing you're telling the child not to do is what the child is doing. So the instruction is inversely proportional to the behavior. Alright, so we said that the instruction given by your parents becomes inversely proportional to the behavior. That's peculiar with teenagers. So we're going to use that, draw a graph and show on the board what they're laughing. They're going to show on the board what mathematicians have to say about this. Now look at this. So this is a parent instruction. And this is what we call teenage behavior. The graph cannot go like this, it will go like this. So this is a typical example of what inverse variation is. You can't forget this one, I know, because that is how you behave, you know now. They tell you, don't do this, the one they have told you not to do, that's the one you want to do. So this is a plain graph. You know, we are very practical in maths, you don't want to be abstract. This is the clear picture of what we are talking about. Now, other details are about the same. So, if I call parents' instruction as P and call teenage behavior as T, it will mean that P is inversely proportional. Now, when you get the word inversely, it means you're talking about what? Reciprocal. So, this will be P proportional to 1 over T. So, that's inverse. Reciprocal is inverse. So P inversely proportional to T will mean P proportional to 1 over T. The other details will still be the same, like P being equal to what? K over T. Now we'll replace this with what? K, so for purpose of clarity, times what? 1 over T, which will be what? K over T. So what will be K here? K will be equal to what? PT. So notice that for inverse, the terms you are relating will multiply themselves when you're looking for K. But for direct, the terms will do what? Divide themselves. I don't know if somebody has seen that. When we talked about direct, the terms divided themselves. But now for inverse, the terms what? Multiply themselves. And this is what you're going to have. Now let's go into our text, exercise 18b, and see examples or questions that can help us drive home this point. So we go to exercise 18b of our reference text. And our reference text for this work is the New General Mathematics for grade 10 or SS1, and we are on page 221, 18b. It says, if D, small letter D, varies inversely as small letter T, use the symbol to show a connection between D and T. That's what we have done. T varies inversely as T means D. D varies inversely as T means D is inversely proportional to what? D proportional to 1 over T. Right. Now let's look at question number 2. A piece of string is cut into N pieces. a piece of string is cut into n pieces of equal length L. These are the things we are looking at. A piece of string is cut into n pieces such that each piece has a length of what? L. Does n vary directly or inversely with L? That's the question. Will n vary directly or inversely with L? Now, let's be very practical. If I have a loaf of bread, let's watch this one. If I have a loaf of bread, the more slices I get from it, the smaller the size of one. The more number, if I increase it, if I slice, I will increase the number of slices, not? But what will happen is that each slice will become what? Smaller. If I cut a loaf of bread into two, you discover that what one person will get will be quite tangible, is that not? But as I keep increasing the number of slices on that bread, what do you think will happen? The piece that will go to you will become what? Smaller. Let me use your, this is a boarding school, so let me use your kitchen environment as one. A meal five persons will share will not be the same as that same meal being shared amongst 30 persons. Is that not? What would you notice? You notice that if you have 30 persons, the portion each person will get will be what? Smaller, is that not? The portion each person will get will be what? Smaller. So invariably, what happens is that the relationship will be what? Inverse. The relationship will be what? Inverse. And the symbol connecting them will be what? So relationship is inverse. Because it's about sharing. If you share a particular thing to more persons, what each person is going to get will be what? Smaller. Exactly. Alright, with that said, let's go to question number 4. I will trust that you can handle question 3 yourself. It says x varies as 1 over y, or x is inversely proportional to y. X varies as 1 over y, or what? X varies inversely as what? 1 over y. Alright, so how do you handle that? Remember the steps. X will be equal to k 1 or k times 1 over y, which means that x will be equal to what? K over y. What's the next thing? It means that k will be equal to what? Xy. Look at this. You multiply both sides by y, it will eliminate this, and you have what? K equal to what? Xy. Now, what are you giving? You are told that x is 22 and y is what? 3. This will help you obtain what? Your k. So it means k will be equal to 22 times 3. And that will give me what? 66. So with this said, you have to now bring this to this point. Look at it. Wherever you have k, now you put what? 66. And that will mean that x will be equal to what? 66 over y. And so the question says, what is the relationship between x and y? The relationship between x and y is this we have what? Obtained. And that's that for that question. So in question 8, we are told that r is inversely proportional to h. Or R varies as what? 1 over H. So what do we do at this point? Step 1. R will be equal to what? K over H. What is K? R H. Straightforward. Or HR. Obeying our laws of the letters of the English alphabet. HR. Is that clear? So we are told that R is equal to 5 when h is equal to 12. That will enable you to obtain, your K. So K will be equal to 5 times 12. 5 times 12 will give you what? 60. Is that not? So with that, we can now substitute this back here. And we have the R is equal to 60 over H. And to look for question 8A, we are told to find R when H is what? 20. I see that. When H is what? 20. So how do you do that? R is equal to 60 over H. That's the expression you're using. What is H? 20. So R will be equal to 60 over 20. And that will be what? 3. Now in B, we are told to find H when R is what? So how do you do that? You still recall again that what? R is equal to what? 60 over H. So in this case, you need to make H the summit of the formula. So this will now be H, R equal to 60, and then H is equal to 60 over R. Now, what is R? 45. So H equal to 60 over 45, and then you reduce to the lowest term. This will give me what? 3. I hope I'm right with that. And this will give me 4. So which means that H is equal to 4 over 3. So I think with this understanding, you should be able to handle any problem as relates to inverse variation. It doesn't go more than this. Even in your JAM, in your WAEC examination, the questions cannot escalate more than this. It can't be otherwise. So it's very direct, and I would expect you, when you sit in your exams, you do not run away from them. Face them head on and get the job done. Okay, this is our Mamu experience, Mamu with Jarvis. Thank you for joining us today. I will trust that in our next meeting, when we look at joint and partial, we'll gain something very, very interesting. Mamu with Jarvis signing out. Don't forget to get to YouTube and subscribe. Thank you very much.